we can now actually begin the service. And I'm going to end up introducing, you know, we have had the opportunity over the years to serve and provide ministry as a spiritual travelers at a variety of churches. And it happens that the four churches where we have spent most of our time providing service are all participating this evening via remote through the pastors of the four churches. So I'm going to introduce each one as it becomes their turn. The first up is our new bridge pastor, Reverend Lewis Mitchell, to welcome us to Alki. Go ahead, Lewis.
Greetings, everyone. It is a joy to see your faces. On behalf of Alki United Church of Christ, welcome to this gathering. Welcome to this service. I want to offer special thanks to the spiritual travelers and to our ministry partners in this gathering and every hand and heart that went into providing this worship setting and service for us. I pray that God is a blessing in each home and in our service tonight. God bless you all.
Am I back? Thank you, Reverend Lewis. And with Verona's help to light the candle now, let me give you some opening thoughts. We light a light. In the name of the God who creates life, in the name of the Savior who loves life, in the name of the Spirit who is the fire of life. And now I would like to welcome Pastor Andrew Conley-Holcom from Admiral UCC, I believe, who will lead us in an opening prayer.
Thank you so much, Joe, and greetings to all of you. I invite you to take a moment and check in with your body. Notice where you're tense or tight, where you are bringing energy from the day. Maybe there was frustration, maybe there was concern, maybe there was hustling and hurrying to get on this Zoom call. I invite you to breathe deeply into that space of constriction and let that breath open up more space inside of your body. God, you are the God who loves bodies. You love human bodies, frail and fragile and temporary as they are. You loved human bodies so much that you, in your infinite wisdom, decided to be born into a human body, through a human body, into a lineage of human bodies, that you might be raised up from a baby to a child to a man to show us the value of human bodies. And you, in your infinite love, led that body of Jesus, all the way up to his confrontation with empire, all the way to the cross, saying, come and follow me, you bodies, you beloved bodies. So God, we ask that tonight you allow this offering, this remembrance, this firsthand account of the presence at the crucifixion to wash over not only our minds and our hearts, but to move through these bodies.
From the witness stand, across from defendant Derek Schoen.
And when something unexpected happens, God, we trust that you're going to be there. You're going to work it with us. So, thank you. Thank you for these bodies. Thank you for the blessing and the love that you pour out on us, and thank you for the forgiveness that you always have available to us to let us laugh at our mistakes and accept your grace at all times. Bless these bodies that they might be blessings to other bodies.
Now I would like to introduce Pastor Paul Mowry from Sausalito Presbyterian. the spiritual travelers have had the opportunity and pleasure a number of times over the last few years of going down and providing service ministry to Sausalito. And for those of you who don't know, our own Reverend Joan Carter, who's a member of the Spiritual Travelers, was the associate pastor there for 18 years. So we have a very special and warm connection. And Paul will now ask the offering for the evening.
Thank you, Joe, and thank you, Pastor Lewis, for having us, and thank you, Pastor Andrew, for your very real and fresh prayer. And I just want to say, before I ask for the offering, how glad I am to be here, and so many folks from Sausalito Presbyterian. And if this is your introduction to the Spiritual Travelers, then you're in for a treat. And if you've seen them before, then you know you're in for a treat. We treasure the Spiritual Travelers in how they breathe fresh life into the traditional stories we know so well, how they fill in the silences between the verses, and how they build out the characters of the biblical stories, giving them flesh and a heartbeat that brings them to life in a new way, to minister us and to us in a new way. So this is a personal and beloved ministry, and this talented community of artists gives generously of their time and talents and treasury to bring the word to life to congregations near and far, and to bring the word to those who are unfamiliar with the Bible or maybe not even interested in the Bible by taking the message and making it relevant to their lives and bringing the real drama of the stories to life. So on this special holy day, when we gather to remember how so long ago the sun set upon a cross as they laid Jesus to rest in his tomb, I hope you'll join me in making a generous offering to bring the word of God to more people through this very special ministry. It's harder to give in the time of COVID. It's easier when the plate is handed to us. Now we have to write a check, or we have to do something really active to support the church. So I hope you'll do that. For those of you from Sausalito Presbyterian, if you use Givelify and you open it right now, you'll see that there's a special button dedicated to this Good Friday service brought to us by the Spiritual Travelers. And now if you'll please pray with me. Beloved God, we give thanks for all the gifts that you have given us, the gifts of life and of love, the gifts of trial, and the gifts of companionship to see us through that. We thank you, God, for your presence in our life now and always. And we pray that the gifts we give back to your church be multiplied and used wisely to bring your word of love and your word of compassion and your word of righteousness and your word of forgiveness to all those we might reach. In your many holy names, we give thanks to you on this very special holy night. Amen.
Thank you so much, Pastor Paul. Sausalito is in our thoughts and prayers tonight, too. DJ? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you that you've delivered will soon deliver you? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm the storms with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. Oh, Mary, did you know? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak the praises of the Lamb. Lord of all creation, Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect plan? That sleeping child you're holding is the great I am. Story is ready to begin, but first, the beginning narration is done by Pastor Amy Hitchens of Normandy Park UCC, who also holds a special place in our heart because she was a chaplain in residence at the hospital in Burien for many years and was in covenant relationship with Alki. So she was in the pews here and occasionally up here preaching in front of us before she decided that she needed to be at have her own pulpit, and she is now working at Normandy Park UCC. So, Amy, the floor is yours.
Those you are about to hear speak were eyewitnesses to the crucifixion, an event that linked them as companions on a journey. A journey that took them from fear and despair to hope and renewal. We join them tonight at the crossroads where doubt and trust intersect, the place where disbelief and belief sit side by side. These witnesses invite us to leave behind the life that has been and to journey toward a life that could be. It is a journey from darkness to light, from death to life.
While Jesus was in the garden speaking to his disciples, suddenly a crowd armed with clubs and swords appeared. Judas was among them. Having identified Jesus with a kiss, Judas stepped aside so that the guards could arrest him. They led him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders had gathered.
Who chose to betray our Lord? Judas, the one who betrayed our Lord. I'd give anything if I could go back and undo what I did. He was my friend. He trusted me, and I betrayed him, and with a kiss. I, who stood beside him every day, who heard him preach and watched him cast out demons, how could I have betrayed him, and with a kiss of all things? I believed them when they told me they just wanted to quiet him. How could I know that they meant to condemn him to death? When I saw what was happening, I tried to undo what I had done. 30 pieces of silver, 30 lousy pieces of silver. I tried to give the money back. I tried to tell them I betrayed an innocent man, but no one would listen to me. Oh, what a fool I was. Oh, what is it to us, they said. That's your problem. The truth of the matter is, they no longer needed me. I was nothing to them more than a nuisance. Have you ever, in a rash moment, committed yourself to something you later regretted? Have you ever betrayed a friend? Well, perhaps then you'll know the agony that I felt. The pain so intense that nothing could erase it. When they refused to take it back, I threw the silver at them and I ran screaming from the temple. But it was too late. The deed was done. That night I hanged myself.
You chose a painful path, Judas. That dark and lonely night that led to betrayal. But you have given. There is no act that God is not willing to forgive. None. Not even one as loathsome as yours.
At the palace of the high priest, they put Jesus on trial. Are you the Messiah? Asked the high priest. I am, said Jesus. Blasphemy, they cried, and they sentenced him to death. Then they took him before Pilate, the Roman governor, for only Rome could confirm and carry out a death sentence. At dawn, in the great open space in front of Pilate's residence, Pilate questioned Jesus, but found no fault in him. But, said the high priest, we have a law, and by that law he deserves to die. Pilate, seeking a way out, sent him to Herod.
I am Pilate. I tried everything I could think of to keep from sentencing him to death. It was easy to see that what charges they had against the man were trumped up charges, and he certainly didn't appear to be dangerous to me. But had I not given in, there would have been trouble for me with Caesar, and that I could little afford. The crowd had taken on such a mob mentality, and when I realized that a riot was imminent, I felt there was nothing for me to do but to give in. I called for a bowl of water, and there at the top of the steps, for all to see, I washed my hands, claiming that I was innocent of the blood of a just man. Do with him as you will, I told the crowd, but in my heart, I knew I wasn't innocent. I had taken the easy way out, and no amount of washing my hands was going to change that fact. To stand up for justice demanded a bigger price than I was willing to pay. Oh, I wish I could go back and do it differently. I thought sending him off to Herod would get me off the hook.
What a disappointment when Herod sent him right back to me. The crowd followed him to Herod's and back again, going on and on and on about his blasphemy and acts of treason. Throughout the anguishing process, Jesus acted with unbelievable restraint. His quiet strength fascinated me. I had never before seen that kind of behavior by someone in his shoes. I was loath to send him to the cross. Well, I thought I had found a way out when I remembered that each year at the time of the Passover festival, we usually released one prisoner. So I gave the mob the choice. Barabbas or Jesus, I asked them. When they hollered back, "Give us Barabbas," I could hardly believe in my ears. A man guilty of murder during an insurrection? Were they mad? And then when I asked what I should do with Jesus, the crowd began an ugly chant. "Crucify, crucify, crucify!"
Pilate, none of us, not even you, can go back in life and redo what we later regret. But take heart, for God's forgiveness covers all our mistakes, no matter how great they are. Be comforted, Jesus lives. He who was crucified because of your failure to stand up to the crowd is risen. You will meet him in the dawn.
Then the governor's soldiers took Jesus to the praetorium. A whole battalion had gathered. Then they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and plaiting a crown of thorns, put it on his head. Then kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!"
My name is Claudia. I am the wife of Pontius Pilate, governor of Judea. I have to tell you that I'm fearful for what my husband has done. That night, after word reached us that they had taken Jesus captive and that Caiaphas was sending him to my husband to be sentenced, I had a dream. Wasn't the first time I had dreamt about Jesus, but this dream was different. When I awoke in the morning, I rushed to share my dream with my husband, but he had already gone out to meet with the crowd. Not knowing what else to do, I sent a message to him through one of the guards. "Do nothing to that man," my note said, "for he is innocent. A spirit has revealed to me in a dream what is about to happen." I have to confess, I had gone to hear Jesus once, in disguise, of course. Oh, Pilate would have been furious with me had he known. But like the others, I was drawn to Jesus like a magnet. When I heard him speak, he stirred something in me that hadn't been touched in years. I think it was hope. Hope for myself and hope for the world. Suddenly, I was yanked from my thoughts when I heard the mob outside cry out for Jesus to be crucified. Then through the window, I watched as my husband deliberately and carefully and slowly washed his hands for all to see. And then he turned Jesus over to the crowd to do as they liked. To do as they liked? How could my husband give in to the mob? How could he? Didn't he know how weak that made him look? I watched the whole awful procession, the pain Jesus was enduring, the tormenting crowd. Finally, I couldn't watch anymore. They were killing an innocent man. Didn't anyone have the courage to stop them? I'm filled with fear and confusion. Jesus touched me with his message of love, his regard for the poor and the outcast. No wonder he haunts my dreams. I feel sick in my heart. I'll be afraid to go to sleep tonight. I'll be afraid to dream. If this man, Jesus, is truly who they say he is, God will surely punish my husband for what he has done.
It's hard to watch those we love make harmful choices, especially when we are fearful of the consequences they and we might have to face. But it's important to remember that the love and forgiveness of God is greater than our shortcomings. Wife of Pilate, God has forgiven your husband. Let go of your fear.
And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes back on him. And then they took him out to be crucified. And as they led him away, they grabbed an onlooker, Simon of Cyrene, and ordered him to carry the cross behind Jesus.
I am Simon's wife. We were strangers in Jerusalem. That day, we had come from Cyrene on family business, excited that it coincided with the Passover festival. Our family is Jewish, and coming to Jerusalem at Passover had been a dream of mine since I was a girl. I'm the first in our family to make it to Jerusalem since my great-grandfather settled in Cyrene. Our visit went nothing like I'd expected. We were on our way to the inn when we heard a great commotion. Roman soldiers were stopping traffic to parade some prisoners dragging their crosses through the city. We tried to get out of the way, but there, in the midst of the crowd, we couldn't get away. Suddenly, one of the prisoners stumbled right there in front of us. He appeared pretty bruised up and wearing some thorny branches on his head, like a strange crown. When he couldn't get up, one of the centurions grabbed my husband and ordered him to pick up the cross. Why didn't my husband refuse to be part of what was being done to this poor man? Much later, we were told that this man was Jesus of Nazareth, and that many believed he was the Messiah. We thought, oh, I don't know what we thought, and for that matter, I don't know what I think even now. The sky going dark, his cry, my God, why have you forsaken me? And all this Messiah business? I only know that I can't get the image of this Jesus out of my mind. What kind of proof would it take to convince me that he truly was who he claimed to be?
Don't be too hard on town, just visitors. It all happened so fast, it must have seemed like a dream to you. Your only encounter with Jesus was a brief one. You were never privileged to hear him tell a parable, or heal a blind man, or hear him teach. Listen to your heart. It will tell you what you want to know.
There followed him a great multitude of people, among them women wailing and lamenting over him. There was Mary, the mother of Jesus, and the other Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, sons of Zebedee. And Mary Magdalene was there too. Mary, his loyal companion and confidant.
I know you look at me and think, Mary Magdalene, who do you think you are? How can you, your type of woman, be a credible witness? Oh yes, I know, I'm only a woman, the one you love to spread wild rumors about. Yeah, I have a past, my life has not been pure, but there's much you do not know about me. My life was so empty before I met Jesus. I was so lost. I longed for something or someone to fill that emptiness. Jesus showed me the way. He loved me out of that deep, deep hole I had fallen into. At first I assumed he'd be like all the others and say what they will to have their way. But he was different. He listened. He called me beloved. He gave me hope. He took my broken spirit and spoke of forgiveness and this amazing thing called unconditional love. I've never known love like that before. He changed me. He changed my world. He changed everything. Then the one who brought me back to life, who called me by my name, he was taken away, gone. And he didn't even put up a fight. I was so confused, so overwhelmed, I didn't know what to think. If only my love could have brought him back. I was changed because of him. How can he be gone? What have they done with my Lord?
I understand only too well your grief, Mary. Deep inside, you fear that your life will revert back to what it once was. To have one's life transformed only to lose the reason behind the transformation is a terrible thing. But take heart, Mary, your Lord lives. His help is just as near as it was before his death. Listen for his voice, and you will find guidance.
And when they came to the palace, the place called the Skull, they crucified him along with two criminals, one on the right and one on the left. And Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And as the people stood by watching, Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom.
I am a centurion in the Roman army. There was such a feeling of unrest in the city that morning. When Pilate washed his hands and turned that fellow Jesus over to us, he must have sensed that things would get out of hand, for he called out the whole battalion. As we marched him into the praetorium, the jeering of the crowd became more intense. I was used to men in this situation cursing and struggling and shouting back at the hecklers, but this man spoke not a word. It puzzled me. At first I thought he must be too weak and cowardly to fight, but then there was a quiet courage in this man, a quiet, powerful courage. Our men clothed him in purple, the cloak of royalty, and someone fashioned a crown of thorns for his head, a shaggy, bearded head. And then some of the soldiers knelt before him, chanting, Hail, King of the Jews! Oh, the crowd loved it. What a show we gave them. Our prisoner just looked at them. And as he slowly moved his gaze from one of us to another, our eyes met for a moment, and there was a wisdom and a sadness in those eyes. And suddenly I became extremely uncomfortable with what we were doing. I wanted to holler out, enough, you've had your fun, now let this man meet his fate in peace. But how could I do that? Why, they would have thought I was losing my nerve. I, who had demonstrated courage on numerous occasions, why, I had a real future in Pilate's army, I couldn't blow that. When we got him up on the cross, the crowd went wild. The rabble-rousing went on for a long time, but finally there was silence. And we began the long wait for death to come. After 3 hours, an eerie darkness began to descend upon us. It brought with it such an air of anxiety. Another 3 hours passed, and suddenly a loud cry pierced the darkness. Some say it was a cry of utter despair, a last protest against his pain. But I tell you, it was more like the cry of a victor. With his cry, the earth began to rumble. At first only slightly, but then with a growing intensity, and suddenly I knew. Well, this was no ordinary man we had crucified. This man was the Son of God.
Centurion, your recognition of Jesus for who he was came from God. At that moment, God forgave you. and now it is time for you to forgive yourself. God's transforming act brings forgiveness and healing.
Flesh of my flesh, bone of my bone, you who I have birthed, held, loved, and raised, and now grieve. My son, my teacher, my Lord, I've known you since you were but a seed, a gift from heaven, heralded by angels, honored by wise men, followed by multitudes, and now dying, alone, forsaken, unheard, I see you. I see you, my sweet, sweet Jesus. I've loved you, my son. I will always love you. Yes, to others you have been healer, teacher, rabbi, the way, the light, salvation. To me, you have been all these things, but only to me have you been sun. The sun that shines so brightly in my heart. And now I know not day nor night, for I feel lost without you. My sweet child. You who so graciously turned water into wine. And now, how can they offer you vinegar when you thirst? The cruelty is unbelievable, unbearable. And yet, somehow, you remain whole and holy. Even as your beautiful hands and feet are pierced, spear-piercing flesh. They jeer. They call you King of the Jews. Oh, if they only knew. In your face, I see my loving son, a wise and humble man, a kind and gentle soul with wisdom beyond your years, insight into each and every moment of life. Oh, how the skies rumble The earth darkens as life fades. In my heart, I will always love you, my son. I will hold you in my heart always, just as I hold my tears. My breath, all there is now, all that's left for me to do is to stand witness to your sacrifice.